Yeah, hello everyone. My name is Peter Brandt. I work for Leap in Australia. We are the distributors for Algorix Momentum in Australia and New Zealand. And I've created this video. It will take approximately half an hour. But if you have the patience to sit through all of it, you will get a very good basic understanding of Algorix Momentum inside space claims. I've tried to cover the basic functions. So if you have any questions afterwards, you can always send me an email, peter.brandt@leapos.com.au. Okay, so here is the model that I want to go through today. It's a hydraulic lift assembly inside Space Claim version 19.1. As you can see here, the model is organized in components. So if you want to use Algorix Momentum, there's a tab over here. All your solids need to be organized in components. Now, Space Claim, if you're not familiar with it, it's a direct modeler. So you can just create things on the fly, geometry. So I'll show you an example. If I just want to create a simple structure here, you just use the pull and the move functionality. So for example, you can create imprints here, like copy edge, imprints at face. I can pull that face in or out. I can combine that with the move tool as well. So I can extrude surfaces. So if I select these ones here and then pick up the surface in the top face and drag it back into a solid, you can keep sketching on this structure as well. So for example, I sketch a circle and drag that into a hole. You can always change the diameter later on, or you can move features by box selecting them, etc. So it's a very easy tool to use to create something. So let me just box select all of this and click on delete. It's also used for simplifying things. So if you look at this part here, for instance, for FEA or CFD, you often want to simplify the geometry. So you can just box select all features, click on the fill, and now you will see that that whole area is simplified. With Control Z, I just undo that action. It has unlimited undo. You can also open and import geometry from different sources. So if you look at all the formats that it can open typical CAD packages like CATIA, UG, Creo, SolidWorks, Inventor, etc. Or neutral formats like STEP, ACES, IGES, STL, Parasolid, etc. Once the geometry comes into Space Claim, you can do the same operations as if I had created it natively in Space Claim. Okay, so now let's go into the Algorix Momentum. Just if you're familiar with this model, I have simplified it because in the original model from Algorix, there was a hidden layer which I have removed. So now my model is called Demo Hydraulic Lift Start PB, Peter Brandt, my name, without that suppressed layer. All right, so if we want to use Algorix, we need to click on the Momentum tab here, and then we click on Activate. So this will basically create rigid bodies in a simulation structure tree. Now, it can be maybe slightly confusing in the beginning that we have two trees. So we have the Space Claim tree, the structure tree for our geometry, and then we have our Algorix simulation structure tree with our rigid bodies for, you know, the mechanical simulation. Also want to show you that this crane is standing on slight inclination. So it has a base under a slight angle. And so once that base is positioned, it will tend to slide down a bit. And we will see that that will indeed happen. Okay, so let's, the first thing is, in order to simulate this structure, we need to split the rigid body. So we can right click it and split it, or you click on split over here. So when you click on split, it will split off each component into its own rigid body. Now clearly we'll end up with a lot of bodies, and all these bodies as a default are dynamic bodies, but you can also select one body and then click on static. That will convert the base to a static body that's basically fixed in space. It won't dynamically move. The other thing is that Algorix is automatically defining contacts between all the bodies. So once I simulate this, it will drop. And why will it drop? Because in settings, there's a gravity defined. So there's a default gravity, which is set here in minus Z direction. And so everything will drop to the base. Also, it uses a time step. The default time step is 1 over 300 hertz. So if I simulate this model, basically, it first gives me a warning. It says that there are more than 3,000 contacts here, because as I said, there's contact between each body. So if we simulate it, it will take a little while, and then it will drop everything basically to the base. Nothing is connected, so there's a bit of random shattering here, but effectively, this is the behavior that we expect. Everything randomly shatters apart to the ground, is not connected. If you want to get rid of those markers, you can go to settings and disable the render contacts here. Okay, so the problem here that there's contacts between each body and nothing is connected. By the way, the contact settings are defined through the material pair. So each model, each body has a material. At the moment, it's an unknown material. And then there are contact settings between the different materials. So there's a friction of 0.15 Coulomb friction and a restitution coefficient, which is a value between 0 and 1. 0 means that there's no bounce back, that they, after contacting, they stick together. Value 1 means there's a pure elastic bounce back. And a value in between means there's a bit of damping and energy loss there during your contact bounce. Okay, the materials, by the way, are defined in the space claim bodies. If you go to property, you see there's a material definition here. Now, that space claim has a material database. So the unknown material has properties of steel, but in effectively only the density is important here. So the density defines the mass of the rigid body by combining all the volumes of the different solids. And the shape, of course, is important too for the contacts. So space claim has a material library, so you could select a different material here. If you go back to your simulation structure tree, so each component now has a mass property that's calculated based on the density of the different solids in that body and the volume of each body. All right, so at the moment we have too many simulation bodies. You can actually display that with dynamic color. So every body has its own color. Now, let's disable that for a sec. And let's merge some of these bodies into larger components. So let's first start with the base. I mean, the base can stay as one body, so we can just hide it. Then we have this part here, so we can select all of them and click on merge. And then you follow instructions here. You select the body into which you want to merge it. Now you see all the parts here have now one color, purple. So they're all merged in one color. This body here can be one of them, the hydraulic piston pin. We hide it. And let's also hide this part here, hide. All the components over here we can merge in one body. So I select them from right to left and then merge them into one body. Okay, so all green now. So let's just select one part, right click and pick that body in the tree. And then when you right click here, select all the solids in that body, right click hide here, we can just basically hide that body there. Okay, the piston pin here, we can also merge that. So we start by selecting these bodies and then triple click this one. Now we have three bodies. Triple click that one, four bodies. This one, five, the pin, six. And triple click this one. So now we've selected seven bodies. And let's split them into one part again. All right, again, we go back and select this part in the same way. So the hydraulic piston, select all the solids here, hide them, and get rid of the dynamic colors. Okay, the rest here, let's put them in one component for now. So select everything, merge it into this body here. But now I want to split off the wheels. So you can select a wheel and click on split. Same here, select the wheel, click on split. This one here, select the wheel, split, and the fourth one as well. So they become separate rigid bodies. If you click on dynamic color, so you see the wheels have different colors. Now let's hide this body. So again, do the same trick. Select that body in the tree, which is part of a bigger assembly. Select all the solids, hide them. So we got our wheels, we can select them, right click and move to new group. And that group here, let's rename it, call it wheels. And let's select and show everything else. So how many components have we got now? We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. If we plot the dynamic color, you see that it looks a lot neater now. And if we would simulate this, it behaves a lot cleaner now. So you see there's no shattering of parts anymore. Still, we see that big, what is it, this big thing, called a big block fall to the ground. And then after that fall, we see the crane slide to the left, which makes sense because under gravity it will slide, so we can stop the simulation. And by the way, I advise you to do a simulation after each change. So every time you make a change, simulate it and see how the behavior is. It's a good way of debugging the model. You can also use the playback here. So that doesn't solve it again. This basically repeats what you just solved. And you can also slow that down a bit. So if I put the speed to 20% and play it, then it is a lot slower and better to watch what's going on. Okay, so that's basically the behavior that we expect. All right, now we need to start connecting parts. So for example, here we want to create joints. Now the easiest way of doing that is use the detect joints here. And this detects joints based on the geometric distance between body and the shape of the bodies. You see here, it has created a few joints. These are basically hints for you. So you can select them and then you can convert them to a different type of joint, like a hinge joint or a prismatic joint, like a translational joint or a cylindrical joint or a lock joint. So you can go through those suggestions. You can also try to find more joints by the options here. You can change the tolerances. If you make that a bit larger, it will find more joints based on geometric distance. So let's go back here. Let's see what joints do we have. So click on that one. It sits over here. So here we want to create a revolute joint between that pin and that part there. So let's create a hinge joint there. So now it has created a hinge joint in the tree. And you go to properties here. You see that that joint has, well, first it has elastic stiffness properties. So 1 degree of freedom is free. That's the revolute joint degree of freedom. The other five are not completely constrained. They actually have a bit of stiffness. So in that case, you could actually model a situation where the joint has some, you know, gaps or a bit of flexibility there. So it's not a hard constraint in the other 5 degrees of freedom. You can also define joint motion here. So I can, for example, enable a motor for the joint, define a range over which the motor operates, a spring, etc. And I will give you examples later on. So let's go to the next joint here. Let's also make that a hinge joint. And this one here, over here, also a hinge joint. This one here, I want to create a cylindrical joint, because basically I want to have rotation but also translational motion, so that we can actually make that a hydraulic working joint. Next one it could be a hinge joint again. This one here, let's also create a hinge joint. And the last one, the last one here that sits over here, that's not a hinge joint. Okay, get rid of the detect joints and go through them one by one. So hinge joint, that's good. Another hinge joint, another hinge. So you see that it displays the bodies in blue that is connected to. So in your simulation tree, it actually selects the components that are connected to the hinge. So that's a way of checking it. You can also, by the way, select the hinge just here in the viewport. So if I select that hinge, it will you select it from the viewport and it will be displayed over there. All right, so now we've got a couple of hinges. And again, let's just simulate it quickly. So that is kind of what we expect. So we see this joint now behaves as a hinge joint. And yeah, everything else behaves as expected. You also see that some joints are not created, maybe based on a tolerance. Some joints were missed, so it's easy to create them by hand. So I can simply go to hinge joint here. You follow the instructions here. So with control, I select the wheel. And then I select the axis over there that creates the joint. Go to the next one, control select the wheel and then the axis. Then over here, control select the wheel and then the axis. All right, so that creates the other joints. So let's again quickly simulate it. And works as expected. Right, stop the simulation. Right, so now we have those joints. So we created some automatic joints. We have some hinge joints. Let's now add a spring. Let's add a spring between the block and the attachment point. So I go to spring joint. I follow instructions. So with control, I select the part. And then I select the attachment point somewhere over here. And then we can select that spring. Oh, it hasn't actually created it. I'll try that again. Control and then pick the bar there. Okay, so now it's created the spring. And you also see that the spring as a default is attached now to the CG of that block. But that's an easy change. So in general, we can change joints, we can change location. So if I go to the normal space frame design tab here, I can go to the move on here, select the joint and place it somewhere else. So I can, for example, place it close to the attachment point there. I can also use functions like the up to place it precisely. But in this case, it doesn't really matter. I just want to place it quite close to the attachment there, somewhere in the center, and then simulate it again. So let's go back to momentum, simulate, and you'll see that the spring behaves. Maybe we should change the stiffness properties of the spring. So I click on the spring here, go to properties, and the spring elasticity, let's make that 100 newton per millimeter, and the damping 0.1. And simulate it again. So now the spring is a little bit stiffer. Also, by the way, you saw how I changed the attachment point of the spring. You can do that with any joint as well. So I go back to design again and go to move. So I can select, for instance, this cylindrical joint here. If I want to orient it, I can click on the arrow here and, for example, change the move direction here and pick the axis of that cylinder, or I can rotate it around 180 degrees. So you can just change orientation of joints, of springs, of anything with normal space claim functionality. You can also use your shortcut so that you don't need to leave the momentum tab over there. All right, so we've got a spring now, we've got our joints. We can also look at the force in that spring. So if I go to the plot menu here, I can select a source here. So this could be, for instance, my spring. And let's pick the force magnitude. So that's the Y value. And for the X value here, I can either select time or I can select an object and then pick the position or angle. But let's leave it as time now. And then if you simulate that that model, it will just give us the force in the spring. Now I can also put that plot next to the simulation by dragging it upwards and then, for example, clicking here. So that puts it next to each other. So then when you simulate it, you see the model simulate and the force at the same time. Okay. Now let's create some motion for our cylindrical joint, our hydraulic cylinder. Let's click on that cylindrical joint, this one over here, and look at properties. Now, first you see you have properties for your angular behavior, but I want to create a property for our linear motor. So if I enable that one, click on true there, and then let's put the velocity to zero. So we want to keep it fixed there for now. And then let's simulate that one here. And so you see that the hydraulic cylinder is actually not working properly because that zero velocity is not maintained. Now, the reason is that if you go back to your properties, the joint behavior here is a target speed. So it's not a fixed constraint. It's actually, it's trying to keep it at zero value there, but it has force limits there. And if they are exceeded, then it disables the joint. I'll show you that as well by adding another plot here. So if we create a new figure, and in that figure, we create, pick the cylindrical joint here. Where is it? Cylindrical. And then let's take the force in Z direction versus time, apply. You see that the force here is small, and every time it exceeds that value of 87 Newton, it's disabled. So let's put that value to a very high value now, minus 120, or you can also use the infinite symbol here in Algorex. So if I put those maximum forces to a very high value and simulate it again, so now you see completely different behavior. So you actually see that that velocity is maintained, so it's not moving, and the force there shows very large values, up to minus, let's say, 18,000 Newton there. So as an example, if I would cut off that force at 10,000 Newton, as an example, so I go back to the motor and put the force limits to minus 10,000 plus 10,000 and simulate it again. So now you will see that, you see here, the force is actually cut off, and you also see when you do the playback that the zero velocity is not able to maintain, right? Because it's cut off. So that's how you can play with those options. So let's go back to our properties, and let's put those values back to minus 120 and plus 120, or as I said, you can use the infinite symbols. And actually, let's give it a target speed here. Let's give it, instead of zero, let's put it to 200 millimeters, for instance. And let's see what that does. So if I simulate it now, it's actually pushing it upwards, because it's pressed apart with a velocity of 200 millimeters a second. The other thing is you can define ranges here. So if I say, let's pick a range here between maybe minus 80 millimeters and plus 80, it will try to push that away with a velocity of 200 millimeters a second. But once it reaches that 80 millimeters displacement, then it will stop. Okay, so that's what's happening here. And at the same time, we see that crane driving. And then once it hits the wall, it will be interesting to see what happens then. So it drives, it does contact, automatic contact, and then it's actually toppling over because that big block weight is actually causing the CG to the right, and the whole thing falls over. So that's very realistic physical behavior that you can simulate here. Now, if you want to prevent that crane from driving, we could, for instance, add a motor to the wheels. So let's pick these two joints here. Let's pick this joint here, and maybe that one with control. So you can define the same properties for both of them, hinge 7 and 8. And these ones also have a motor, so we can set that one to true and keep the velocity to zero. And then again, we probably need to do something with those torque limits, otherwise they may override the behavior that I wanted to do. Okay, so now if we simulate it and we zoom in on those wheels, there should be a zero velocity there, unlike the wheels at the front, which actually rotate. Now it's still sliding because there's an inclination on that base. So even if I define a velocity of zero there, it will still slide because the friction is not large enough. And also, maybe I should add some heavy blocks there. So the first thing I can do, I could go back here and increase the friction. So make it, for example, 0.5. And we can see if that makes a difference. We can also maybe add some heavy blocks there. So let's go to the space claim again. And let's sketch something here. So I sketch maybe something on this face and create a heavy block here. Actually, let's just sketch a block. And let's do the same over here. So I create a block here, a sketch. And the dimensions, it doesn't really matter too much. Just make up something. And when you go to your space claim tree, now I need to pick those two solids and right click and move each to new component because LGRIX requires a component. And then in your simulation tree, we should see a new component here that we can split. And so now we have two additional rigid bodies for these blocks here. And then we can maybe give them a really large mass. So make it 1E6 for this one and for this one as well. Just make them really heavy, 1E6. And then let's connect them to the rest of the model with a lock joint. So I select the body, face here. So with control, I select the body and the face. So let's see what happens now when we simulate this body. It will have more friction. There will be heavy weight there. And I expect it now to slide, have more difficulty sliding. It will still slide a little bit. But then once it reaches that that wall, it will hopefully not topple over. Actually, I don't know if we should wait for that. Anyway, let's do something else while that's running. Actually, I'm going to stop that. And let's also change the shape here. So for instance, the base here, I can go back to the normal space claim and add a fillet here. So I can change the behavior here. So let's add a fillet here. Or before we do that, let's undo that. Let's actually do something else. Let's create a copy edge here. And let's imprint this edge over here. Then we pick up that face and pull it upwards up to the face over here. Then we could maybe move this face down. So I can use a ruler here and define an exact distance, maybe 20 millimeters between that face and that face. And then I can even add fillet here. So with pull, let's create a fillet here. You know, now we create a kind of ramp. And we can even move this a little bit closer. So if I go to move, box select this whole area, click on the arrow and move direction, change it. So now we can make this a little bit closer to the wall here. Okay, so let's simulate this model here. Let's see what happens here. All right, let's do something else as well. Let's actually go back to the wheels, to our simulation structure. Pick these two large hinges, these two hinges there. So for example, this hinge, actually let's select it from here. Let's first go to this one here. Pick that hinge and go to properties. And instead of using a zero velocity, let's give it a target speed, maybe 200 mils a second. And this one here, you see that it's actually oriented differently. So the arrow here is going up over here, it's going the other way. So I probably have to define minus 200 here, but that's very easy to verify by just simulating it. So we go back here and simulate it. Let's see how the wheels rotate. Let me zoom in. So I think I have the wrong direction. This one seems to rotate in the wrong direction now. Anyway, it doesn't matter. I can easily change it. So now it's basically rotating. So because the other one is moving backwards. Actually, let's change that. So I go back here and go to this joint in the tree. This one over here, hinge 8, And let's make a target speed of 200 instead of minus 200. Let's see what happens then. Simulate. Okay, so now it's driving the right direction. And this is a motor now on the hinges. It will push that one towards the wall. And yeah, so now you see it pushes it through. And the crane is actually going over that little bump. And that all works fine. The last thing I wanted to show you is that you can also use something called the sequence editor. And the sequence editor is a way to generate motion with time delay. So you can also combine it with scripting, by the way. So let's say I pick these two hinges or select them from there. And with control, I select my cylindrical joint as well. Where is it? This one over here. And I right click and I use the sequence editor. So now I can go back to the sequence editor here. And now I can, for example, tell it to activate this motor only at a certain time. So for example, I can add an operation over here, define a time in the sequence editor. And then I can say this motor, let's add an operation here, for example, only starts after 2 seconds. Right, and that's how you can set up the model in a more organized way using the sequence editor. And that will activate a joint only at a certain time. Again, as I said, you can also add mathematical operations by using script editors. You can do everything in your script editor by just using a Python programming language. But basically, this concludes my demo. So if you have any more questions, please send me an email, peter.brand@leapos.com.au. As I said, we are the distributor of Elgrix in Australia, and Elgrix has been so kind to enable us to put our video on their YouTube channel. So their YouTube channel has lots of additional videos that shows the behavior of Elgrix. Hopefully this was of use to you, and yeah, send me an email if you have more questions. Thank you.